Reading is a reading from the Acts of the Apostles. As the number of disciples continued charged to the priests for the code of obedience to the faith. The word of the Lord.
Thank you, God.
Thank you. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God. Have faith also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If there were not, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. Where I'm going, you know the way." Thomas said to him, "Master, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, then you will also know my Father. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said to him, "Master, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you for so long a time, and you still do not know me, Philip? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own. The Father who dwells in me is doing his works. Believe that I am the Father, and the Father is in me. Or else, believe because of the works themselves. Amen, amen, I say to you, whoever believes in me will do the works that I do, and will do greater ones than these, because I am going to the Father." The Gospel of the Lord. A lot of good readings this weekend. Of course, I'm very fond of the first one because it talks about the vocation of deacons. But I'm going to talk a little bit about today about faith. And do you know why faith is like Wi-Fi? We all use Wi-Fi, don't we? So, because it's invisible, but it has the power to connect us with what we think we need. But how often do we fail to stay connected with Jesus and to what he tells us? Like he told his disciples today in the gospel, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God, have faith in me." So, what is it to have faith? And often we talk about our beliefs as they're interchangeable with our faith. But today's gospel, we see a subtle difference between the two. That's because we also confuse belief and knowledge with faith in its true sense, and it really isn't there. Now, Philip's question to Jesus demonstrates the problem that we all face in truly embracing faith. Now, by this time, if you follow the gospel, the apostles had spent a few years with Jesus, and they'd given up all their livelihood to follow him and to spread his teachings throughout the region. And as his ministry is coming to an end, Jesus knows that his departure is truly going to frighten and confuse the disciples. So he stresses that they must have faith that he will assure that they will join him in heaven. Now, after their long association with Jesus, asking for faith seems a little strange to the apostles, because haven't they seen his works and seen him teach more than anyone else? They already know that he is Jesus and Jesus to be the Christ. They understand that. But really, they don't fully understand what it means for Jesus to go to Jerusalem. Because we know what happens to him in Jerusalem, don't we? So they know who Jesus is, and they believe what he teaches. But knowledge and belief on their own are not faith, are they? Philip makes this clear when he asks Jesus to show us the Father. You see, Philip's question demonstrates a hesitancy to trust Jesus. You know, Philip says, "Hey, just show us God, and I'll be on board, and everything's going to be cool." He wants to see God. Once again, the disciples show us our own Father. When we find ourselves struggling with doubt or unwilling to relinquish our illusion that we're completely in control of everything in our lives, as we think we are, don't we? Don't we start trying to do things the way we want to and to fit God into our own patterns rather than fit ourselves into His? But we know we can't possibly fit God into our own little boxes, no matter how highly we think of ourselves or our own powers. But we certainly try, don't we? Jesus asks us for faith, for the disciples to trust that Jesus will lead them to the Father. And Philip and the rest of us, we prefer that God just shows up here instead. And that would be nice, wouldn't it? But this, once again, is trying to make God's will subservient to our own, rather than ours to Him. Jesus wants us, His followers, to trust that He is the way, the path that leads to the Father, that we all can take. But that means more than just knowing it exists and believing in the truths. It means putting our trust in Jesus Himself, forming ourselves through His Word, and relying on His plan rather than clinging to our own. Now, our second reading today hints to the same theme, as Peter makes a similar point as Jesus, as he refers to the cornerstone, that those who trust in Jesus and not just believe will not be put to shame. However, Peter goes on, and he says, but for those without faith, they stumble by disobeying the word, as is their destiny. Now, the cornerstone, we know, is the key element to any building, the one which holds the entire structure and puts it at rest. And we have to understand that both the builder and the occupants, we have to trust that cornerstone will endure and uphold in its mission. Now, Peter, he also quotes Psalm 118 in his reading, but with a little added twist about that cornerstone. Because he says that, of course, that stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. And of course, we know that this all points to Jesus, but also for us to trust Him more than we trust our own reason. And that's hard for us to do as humans, isn't it? And while we may believe that today's gospel clearly tells us the truth about our salvation, we must understand that we can't get there without trusting in Jesus, and without putting ourselves on His path versus thinking that we can do it better on our own. And as one of these popular communication advertisements says that we see all over the place, stay connected with Christ. And as we talk about staying connected, today we celebrate another very special day for a large majority of our parish. And of course, that's our mothers. And what a blessing that Mother's Day is celebrated in May, of course, which is the month dedicated to Mary, our Blessed Mother. And as we honor our mothers, it's the perfect time to honor Christ's mother and the mother of our church. What a perfect model and example for all mothers, and for fathers too, as to how to commit ourselves to selflessly raising our children to be better people in our community. Now, if you're not aware, I have the best mom in the world. I think we'll all say that, won't we, about our mothers? And of course, how's that perfect child? Now, I know, wait a minute, I didn't get to finish that statement, because I was the perfect child to test my mother's faith and her trust in God. That I would first survive childhood, and then second, become a fruitful member of society, because I surely was a handful. So for all of her patience and prayers, the Lord knows I needed a lot of them, I thank my mom for all she's done to make me the God-loving person that I am. I know with her persistence and God's help, I think I turned out okay, although I'm a work in progress like we all are. But I do love my mother very much. And of course, I got to recognize my better half when I talk about mothers too. That's my wife, Renee, who demonstrated such a commitment and love to our two beautiful daughters over the years. And it's through her efforts that these two beautiful women have become productive mothers and beautiful members of this society. I love you, Renee. And I think that Theodore Roosevelt captured the essence of what a mother is in his speech he penned in 1934 when he signed the proclamation making Mother's Day a nationally recognized holiday. And I quote this, When all is said and done, it is the mother, and the mother only, who is a better citizen than the soldier who fights for his country. The mother who does her part in rearing and training aright the boys and girls who are to be the men and women of the next generation is of greater use to the community and occupies, if she only would realize it, a more honorable as well as more important position than any man in it. She is more important by far than the successful statesman or businessman or artist or scientist. End quote. And with that said, make sure you take the time today, tomorrow, of course, on Mother's Day, to thank your mother for all that she's done for you. And even if she's no longer among you, offer up grateful prayers to God for saying yes to life, your life, as Mother Mary did for Jesus. And as it is a Catholic tradition, on behalf of Father Adam and the staff at St. Stephen First Martyr Catholic Church, we'd like to extend our wishes of a blessed and happy Mother's Day to all our mothers who labor unceasingly, that they and their children gain eternal joy in heaven. And most especially, let's offer thanks and praises to the Holy Trinity for the great mother of our Savior, Mary, most holy. Happy and blessed Mother's Day, everybody. Amen. Amen.
Annual meal. We pray to the Lord.
cabinet, for all leaders throughout our country, both civil leaders and church leaders, and for leaders throughout the world, that they will be open to the Holy Spirit at work in their lives and their decision making, and also in the lives of their peoples. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who travel, for their safety, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And gracious God, these are our prayers. We ask that you would grant them in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed.
By the oblation of his body, he brought the sacrifices of old to fulfillment in the reality of the cross, and, by commending himself to you for our salvation, showed himself the priest, the altar, and the lamb of sacrifice. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. When supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with Blessed Joseph, Mary's spouse, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession, in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant, Francis, our Pope, and Gregory John, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Let us pray. Graciously be present to your people, we pray, O Lord, and lead those you have imbued with heavenly mysteries to pass from former ways to newness of life through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And just a few quick announcements, of course. We appreciate you donations for the flowers out there for Mother's Day. If you want to take them to your mothers, that's great. If you want to just go ahead and send dedication, you're in the church, we'll eventually get them planted in the garden, and that'll be a living memorial. But whatever way you pursue, it's a good way to recognize your mothers. So thank you for supporting us there. Also, we want to thank Father Mitch, of course, for presiding over the Mass. Thank you, Father. And everybody, sit except our mothers. We'll do a blessing for our mothers, okay? And loving God, as a mother gives life and nourishment to her children, so you watch over your church. Bless these women, that they may be strengthened as Christian mothers. Let the example of their faith and love shine forth. Grant that we, their sons and daughters, may honor them always with a spirit of profound respect. Grant us through Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you, Mother Church.
Read all the numbers. 731-7568.
Oh my goodness.
We're better chicken dinner.
Yeah. Yeah.
By the way, there was a kid in this one that I found.
Who's our lucky winner? Filled with the blessings and gifts of the risen Lord.